Okay, what I will discuss is the space-time described by the Kappa-Minkowski commutation relation. So those are the Kappa-Minkowski commutation relation. This is a non-commutative geometry, one of the oldest one, and Shan knows a couple of things about them. And I will ask the kind of questions which are that were originally asked about quantum phase spines. So I will ask what are the possible wave measurements, the states, their localization, what happens when I change observer? Because of course this is connected with Kappa Poincaré, and I will discuss this. I will be very, very basic, and I will follow Dirac's correspondence principle. There is an apostrophe missing here. So I will associate two coordinates and all observables in general, operators on a Hilbert space, consider the spectrum, their eigenfunction, and the spectral decomposition. Now, this is an assumption, which is some sort of a Copenhagen Kappa-Minkowski. I'll assume that the eigenvalues are the possible results of a measurement of the observables, and use the standard apparatus of quantum mechanics, but, so this is a quantum theory, but I will not consider conjugate momenta and their commutation. So H will play no role, except that I will first remind you some well-known aspects of quantum mechanics and quantum phase space. So I will first consider quantum phase space, where the parameter of deformation is H bar. Then I will go to quantum phase space and will consider only Kappa Minkowski. I will not in this talk, because I don't know yet what to do, to consider all of them. So I will only consider, for what Kappa is concerned, the space-time. Okay, so this is a case study, quantum phase space of a particle, which is the most studied one. I will say some things which are completely known, but I will want to remind them because I will use them to compare with Kappa-Minkowski. So, phase space is a six-dimensional, can be any number of dimensions, of course, but it's a two-n-dimensional phase, which is spanned classically by these six coordinates, position and momenta. And quantization means that means lots of things, but the most elementary one, that Q and Q don't commute, and they have a non-commutation, which is this one, which is this h-bar. And the idea, starting with Heisenberg, is that I represent these objects as operators on an Hilbert space. And usually, Schrödinger point of view, I take a Hilbert space L2 over R3, so I have a six-dimensional space, quantum phase space, but I usually represent it on a three-dimensional L2 over three dimensions, and this is the usual representation. Q is a multiplicative operator, and P is a derivative. Now, Q and Q are unbounded self-adjoint operators with a dense domain, and the spectrum is a real line for each of the direction, for both of them. They have no eigenvectors, but they have improper eigenfunctions, which are distributions. I don't want to go too much into the improper eigenfunctions and something, but I will need. But I know that there is a spectral theorem, a spectral decomposition, and so on. The QIs commute, and so I can have a possible simultaneous improper eigenvalues of all of them. So they have a common base. And they are the Dirac deltas for a particular Q bar. So if I have, for each point on space, of configuration space, I have a vector in R3. For momentum instead, for a particular momentum, I have proper eigenfunctions which are plane waves. Now, let me just think a little bit of these plane waves. The eigenvalue equation of the derivative momentum is a IH bar times the derivative, so I have to solve this for the eigenvalue equation. It's solved by any exponential, of course, with the vector alpha. But no function of this is square integral, and therefore there are no proper eigenfunctions. But the operator P is self-adjoint in the domain of some absolutely continuous functions. And alpha must be pure imaginary, because only if alpha is pure imaginary, distributions are well-defined on the domain of self-adjoint operators. So that's how I get that the spectrum of P is the real line, because there is an I here and an I here. So this is important, because otherwise I would have any exponential. And I still don't have an L2 function, but I have a distribution. Now, a plane wave is not a square interval function, but it's just about us. Because if I put a very tiny real part to the exponential, then at one of the two ends, it will badly blow up. So I take a compromise. It never really blows up, but it's not an L2 function. But, and one can get Reed and Simon or whichever book, good book of quantum mechanics, and see that what you need is a distribution which has to be well-defined of the domain of the operator. So, now, what are the improper eigenfunctions? They are physically interpreted as infinite plane waves of precise frequency. Now, they are not vector in the Hilbert space, and there is no quantum state which would give us a measure exactly the value h bar k. Nevertheless, we all have learned to live with this fact, and there is a sense in which we talk of a particle of momentum h bar k. It means that we have to smear the function which has sufficiently localized Gaussian, for example, and something. So I will use the apparatus of self-adjoint operators, but I will allow myself to talk about, for the Kappa Minkowski case, about this kind of things. Now, what have we done? Why did we have six operators and we were representing only on square interval function of half of the dimensions? Well, this has to do with the fact that the Q is a complete set of observables, and the description of a quantum state as a function of position is the density probability to find the position at Q. So I had, when I talk of wave functions, I have chosen my complete set, and this is the Q. So the psi, however, is complex, and contains all the information about the density probability of the momentum operator as well. And in fact, I could choose Pi as a complete set. Then I have the Fourier transform, phi. So this is, again, a complete set. They will have their own functions. And this phi is the Fourier transform. And it's important that the Fourier transform is an isometry. So if I have is an L2 isometry with some pi factors. And the pi factors are important. Either one of square root of pi on both sides or 1/π when you do the transform. Because it means that if I have a normalized state and I do the Fourier transform divided by 3π, I still have a vector, and they correspond physically to the same state. And then, of course, I have other choices. I have number operator, angular momentum, and so on. So I just reminded you what we do for quantum mechanics. I want to do the same thing. So this was for quantum phase space, and the parameter of non-commutativity was H. Now I want to reproduce this for Kappa Minkowski. This is a four-dimensional space with different commutation relation and a deformation parameter, which I will call lambda, which is 1/kappa, the original kappa. I find it more convenient to have something in the numerator. So when lambda goes to zero, I go to the commutative case. This is a quantum space, and I will only consider its kinematics and leave H bar alone for the moment. But it is a relativistic space, and I will worry about Poincaré transformation later on, briefly. So I want to look for a representation of the x mu on L2 of R3, and this is a representation. It's not unique. There is a paper by Marianak and collaborators where they give the most general representation, but this is somehow the the simplest, the most essential one. So I will consider position operator as multiplication operator, and they form a complete set of observables. And then the time operator is basically a dilation operator, sum over I of xi dxi, which I can write as r dr, where r is the polar coordinate. And the 3/2 is here because x and d don't commute. So if I want a symmetric ladder self-adjoint operator, I have to add this term. And this is half, basically, number of dimensions. So this is now my operator. Now, there are positions are multiplications. And this is what I just said. Now, I notice that there is a dilation here. So I think that it's better to go to polar bases. So instead of having x1, x2, x3, I will have r, theta, and phi. Now, theta and phi are horrible functions, but it means that I will decompose my functions in spherical harmonics and r part. So these are the Kappa Minkowski commutation relation with the standard functions of theta and phi, or any function at all, right? Could have written spherical harmonics here, any spherical harmonics. And instead, x0 commuted with r is I lambda r. And there is an uncertainty relation forced by this operator. And this tells me that delta x0 delta r is larger than equal lambda over 2, the absolute value of the expectation value of r. The operator is self-adjoint, again, on all absolutely continuous functions of R. And of course, the measure as R squared dr and everything. So now, I can ask myself, what is the spectrum of this time operator? Monomials in R are formal solution of the eigenvalue problems. This is the solution of this for any lambda alpha. For this I call lambda alpha, for any exponent alpha. But again, I have to go through the fact that they have to be well-defined distributions, or if it's self-adjoint, the spectrum has to be real. And so the spectrum is real if and only if alpha is -3/2, and here there is a fundamental I which is missing. I'm sorry, this is... There is an I here, which will appear later on, which is the most important thing, of course. I'm sorry. And tau goes from minus infinity to infinity. So the spectrum of time is really the real line, as you would expect. The spectrum of R is the half line, but the spectrum of tau, the time goes from minus infinity to infinity. And so for momentum with plane waves, in this case, we have the following distributions, which are the plane waves for time, or, well, they're not waves at all, but they are r to the -3/2 minus I tau, in order that you have to write as a log, and in order to have the dimensions come all right, you have to put this factor here. Again, this lambda is a somewhat arbitrary choice. It's a natural one, but there could be a length here. So they don't make much of a difference because now it's log of r minus log of tau, it would be. And let me make a comment here. Now, I integrate with the measure, which is r squared dr. So here, r to the -3/2, then there is an r squared becomes r to the -1/2. This is not an integrable function, but like a plane wave, it's the best compromise that you can get. If this -1/2 were a tiny bit below or above, the function would go very badly, either at the origin or at infinity. No, but we know that r to the -1/2 is not integrable at both parts, but just about. So it's like the plane wave. It's the distribution that you want. But it's this term here. So for quantum phase space, I had three Qs and three Ps, and they were going back and forth among them. Now I have R, theta, and phi, but I have another set of complete set of observables, which is tau, theta, and phi, and I can switch among them with what? Well, with quantum phase space, the distributions were exponential e to the ikx plane waves. Here they are monomials with a certain power. So instead of Fourier transforms, now I have Mellin transforms. So if I have this function, which is a function on R3 of space, then I can take the Fourier, the Mellin transform with respect to a psi tilde of tau, theta, and phi. Now this is the angle, so it's a space in which I give the angle and then give the, and I give time. Okay, so I have the two, and I can go back and forth. And probably I say it later on, but what is important is that, again, with proper factors, which are these ones, the Mellin transform is an L2 isometry. So if I have a L2 function on R, theta, and phi, I can, with a Mellin transform, have a L2 function tau, theta, and phi. So I can measure position, but only the radial part, with, if I want, with arbitrary precision, but I don't have eigenfunctions. But then I make a transform, and I make a Mellin transform, and there is something which instead is the function in time space. So I have radius and time space, and I exchange between the two. Angular part doesn't play a role. It commutes with everything. Okay, this is just a comment. It's useful to have an idea of the dimensional quantities which are involved here. Like if I have P and Q, I cannot localize a particle, but then in any good book of quantum mechanics, at some point they tell you that, yeah, you can have a packet that for all practical purposes is well localized in space and time, because h bar is very small. So the, if I call t the eigenvalue of time, which is x0 divided by t, then this tau is time, tau is dimensionless, is tau times this dimension c lambda. Now this is a dimensional quantity, and if I choose for lambda the Planck length, which is a natural choice, this number is 10 to the 43 times 2. So if t is 1 second, this tau is 2 times 10 to the 43, so it's an extremely large number. It means that the oscillation will be so rapid that they will basically cancel. Of course, if tau is the order of Planck time, then tau is of order 1. Okay, so there are large numbers, so these phases basically perhaps will kill things everywhere. Now, I want to give some examples of localized states. In the paper there are more, but I'll give you one. So I take this state, which I chosen to simplify localization, which is a state which is localized in space in a small region around a point at distance z0 from the origin, and I go on the z-axis because I can, it's easy to do calculation. The choice for this is that the Mellin transform will be very simple. I don't do the explicit things, but it's very simple. So the particle is localized in this conical cylinder and of length A, and the opening of the cylinder is the cosine of theta is 1 minus A over lambda, so this is a length. And if I send A to 0, and I keep fixed Z0, then this little blob becomes a point, okay, in a controlled way, because I squeeze the A and I squeeze the angle. So those are a sequence of states, like the Gaussians that you make narrow and narrow, which converge to something which is very localized with a with something which will go to infinity when a goes to zero, because of course the function has to be localized. So it's basically a constant in a small region, and when region becomes small, the constant goes very high. The Mellin transform, and if I integrate out the angular variables, there is no dependence on theta, which gives a 2 pi, is this one. Okay, this tends to a constant which vanishes as a goes to zero. This means that localizing in space implies delocalizing in time. This is exactly the same thing which happens if you have a Gaussian or a step function in position. If you have a Gaussian in position space and you squeeze it, the Fourier transform of this will go to a Gaussian which is wider and wider and goes to zero weakly. The area is always the same into everything. So here, if I integrate the whole series, it will be it will still be a normalizable function, but the peak goes to zero. So so localizing in space implies delocalizing in time. So if I know where the particle is, well, probably talking about the particle is not really a good, the state is, I don't know when it is. Since position, radius, and time don't commute, I cannot know at the same time where a state is localized in space and time. But you then, but then there is a similar, it turns out that the series expansion around zero and Z0 around infinity are the same. Z0 and A appear one in the denominator, one in the denominators. So this means that I either if I try to squeeze and localize the particle, or if I take a particle which is very far away. In both cases, I don't know when. I keep saying the particle because that's a good way of thinking, but it's really a state in a quantum theory. And this is the uncertainty of Kappa Minkowski. Now, there is an exception, however. I can sharply localize a state at a point, and this is the origin. So this is unlike quantum mechanics. There is a particular point which is exceptional, and this is the origin. And in fact, I can consider the log Gaussians. They are, well, they are this. Instead of having r minus r0, I take their logs. I could rewrite this in a number of ways. And I take the width of this log Gaussian. And okay, this is expliciting the normalization, which is, of course, is important because that when you take limits, these functions have a maximum in r equal to r0, and they localize, which localizes in r0. When you send sigma to 0, they get more and more sharply localized around r0. And as r0 goes to 0, they localize at r equal to 0 for any value of sigma larger than 0. So I can do some sort of a double limit and localize the particle at the origin. Now, how did we find this space? Well, because they are the Mellin transform of ordinary Gaussians, up to phases and normalization. So, remember that for time, the integral goes from minus infinity to infinity. It's for R that they go from zero to infinity with a measure. So if I want to, I try to localize a particle around t equals zero with a Gaussian, I can. And if I make the Gaussians sharper for the origin, it only makes the particle sharply localized. So I can localize precisely, always in the sense of distributions, a particle at the origin. Now, since time, okay, this is in the double limit, I just described this in word, this double limit, and you can measure that all Rn and x0 to the n go to zero as sigma going to infinity. So it means that I can localize sharply. This is a state which is localized in time and space, but I can localize at an arbitrary time because a shift in time is just a multiplication by a phase. And then when I take the expectation values or the modulus, this phase will disappear. So I can localize around any time. So it's, what happens is that I can localize a particle at the origin at any moment in time, but only at the origin. If I'm away from the origin, I cannot localize. And I will call this, this origin states with an abuse of notation as O tau. And again, this is the same way in which we use the ket x of the ket k. It's an abuse of notation because there is no L2 state which corresponds to it, but it's a state in a distributional sense. Okay, so the origin is a special point in this game. And does it mean that there is the, in the universe somewhere there is the origin, so there is a special position which is singled out by the kappa god that sits at that origin? Okay, now, in our discussion, we are referring to states and we are assuming the existence of an observer measuring the localization of states. This is implicit in any discussion. So when I talk of the origin, it means that this is my origin. This for me, for the observer located at the origin, either you can call either me or Alice sometimes, here and now makes sense. So I can have something which is localized here and now, but I cannot localize states which are far away. Far away, they are blurry. There is an uncertainty. But what about other observers? So there can be a different observer in a different place, and perhaps he can localize where he is, but he cannot localize me. Now, clearly, this is not true for Kappa Minkowski if I do translations, because if I make a translation, translation is broken. The states which I'm describing are not localized. Point is that I shouldn't do translations. I shouldn't use the Poincaré group, because I remind you that the origin of Kappa Minkowski is from Kappa Poincaré, and again, Majid and Rouet were the one that did it, basically. So, if I want to change observers, I should use Kappa Poincaré, not Poincaré. So there is no surprise that this theory is not Poincaré invariant, because it should be Kappa Poincaré invariant. Now, when we talk of Kappa Poincaré, it's probably a misnomer. There should be Kappa Poincarés. There is more than Kappa Poincaré. Usually say that there are more than one basis of Kappa Poincaré. Majid Reg, by cross product, and so on. Now, this is somehow a misnomer, because a basis means that you have a linear structure, you make a linear transformation. But Kappa Poincaré is both in Hopf algebra, you don't have anymore the linear structure. So I do, some physical consequences of the different bases may be or are in general different. For example, we heard yesterday about dispersion relations. So they are different in different bases. And if you take dispersion relation to a physical meaning, because they are the Casimir of the theory are different in different basis, probably one should say realizations, but if one makes the assumption that these dispersion relations, these Casimirs are related to dispersion relations, then there are dispersion relations which have a physical meaning and they would be different. So I will use a particular basis of Kappa Poincaré group. And I don't know what happens with other bases. This paper has been put on the archive last week, and work is in progress, so things may be little different or very different if you take different realization and different basis. So I will require transformation, the invariance under this transformation, x goes into x prime with a Lorentz transformation and a translation, but I will use the commutation relations of this kappa Poincaré group, which are this one. They are not unique, there can be other ones, and I will be delighted if someone takes and does the analysis for the other ones. Obviously, I will probably try to do them myself or someone in our group. But notice that the Lorentz parameters commute, but the translations don't commute. And here, actually, this is written then mu zero, but they reproduce kappa Poincaré. Ai A0 is I times A0, and the Ai commute among themselves. So translations commute among themselves, but time translations don't commute. And Lorentz transformation times translation is this expression. They are coming from this coproduct and antipode, and this is one of the bases. Of course, these two are connected, so there are various bases of realization of this, and they will give different things. I've chosen one. So we represent the kappa Minkowski algebra as operators, but in doing so, we have chosen an observer. So in order to take into account the fact that there are different observers, we enlarge the algebra in the space to include the parameters of the new observer. So not only I have a state localized or a space of states in space-time, but I have a space of observers. So the final algebra will be positions and where the observers are with respect to a chosen starting observer. And I will call the new set of states PK, this P for Poincaré. So my generalized Hilbert space will now comprise not only functions of space-time, either R or tau, but also functions of the I, of the A's. Now they don't commute, so I can take either A0 or AI and the lambdas. And I can represent this kappa Poincaré group faithfully as this expression, and it's not an immediate thing to see, but it works. See, it has is quadratic in the Lorentz parameters, and it has these omegas are the parameters of a Lorentz transformation, and it depends also on this enlarged space. So I am not a lot of time, and I will not show you how to get this, which was basically found. It's no algorithm. And however, the lambda, the parameters of the translation are complicated, but the lambdas have to commute among themselves, and so one takes them as multiplicative operators. Lambdas are redundant because they are 4x4 matrices, so there will be 16 parameters, but there are actually only 6 parameters, which are 3 which describe a rotation and 3 which describe a boost. So, and there are these omegas here, that there are 6 of them. In the paper there are all the details, I don't want to go into the detail. So we have therefore that like space-time, the space of observer is also non-commutative, and non-commutativity is only present in translation. So if I'm here, and I'm Ellis, and Bisguajit of Bob is there, I cannot know where he precisely is, because I cannot localize the other observer, and vice versa, of course. So there is, spaces are, we have to go one step more than localization of states, but also observers are not localized. And so the space of observers are also states. There are states in the space of observer. And I can have observers which are localized in, they make sense if they're localized at some point, but they have an observer which is an entangled space of Bishwajit and Gianni and or two maxima or something. Everything is in everything is to be quantized. But I can define the origin, and it's not trivial that if I have an identity transformation, this identity is done through the co-unit, because I can make a transformation from me to myself, and this is well defined. So I have a family of observers, but not only me to myself, only moved in time. So the origin if I am an observer, I know that I will be the same observer, sharply localized, even in the future, and I was this in the past. So this is actually good, and this is actually one important thing of Kappa-Minkowski that people don't realize. Kappa-Minkowski is coming from Kappa Poincaré, as symmetries that, for example, Moyal doesn't have. Moyal basically breaks rotations, of course, because Moyal is not guilty of this, because there is no symmetry between X and P, and Moyal was doing X and P. Now, if we force this to do for space-time, it breaks symmetry, and there isn't much to do. Okay, then this is what I said. And in general, coincident observers are well-defined. Are a well-defined concept in Kappa-Minkowski space-time. Now, a change observer will transform, as I say, this, and if I identify X with the identity time X, I generate an extended algebra, which extends, there should be probably some K in the substitute here, which extends Kappa-Minkowski to the Kappa-Poincaré group algebra. This algebra takes into account position states and observables, and this is what I've said. We cannot sharply localize position nor operators. But notice, since Lorentz transformation commute among themselves, we can say if two operators are just rotated or boosted among themselves. So what is important is the distance, not the rotations, which somehow makes sense, because as you get away, you are more and more localized. Okay, now we can try to build the action of the position, translation, and Lorentz transformation on generic functions of variables. And this is actually, I'm cheating slightly, I say to simplify notations, we can really do the calculations only in 1+1 dimension. Things otherwise get a little bit out of hand. And there are only two position coordinates, two translation coordinates, and one Lorentz, this is a Z, transformation, which is parameterized by the rapidity. And I can write down very simply what things are, because the Lorentz transformation is hyperbolic rotation, so that's parameterized by hyperbolic cosine of sigma. And I have two translations which have this commutation relation, and a zero with the sigma becomes very simple, and the action on the space of momenta of Poincaré becomes this object here, which is relatively simple. It's much simpler than the one that I described before, and so I can consider a non-entangled state, which is a position, function of position times a generic Poincaré transformation. So this is a pure translation, would be a Poincaré transformation of the state at the origin, which is what we really are interested in. You know, a part which I localize here, what happens if I move it around. So the new observer measures coordinates with x prime. The expectation values of normalized states is this one. One can calculate, And one finds, not surprising, that the average value of the translated state has to do with the translations and the Lorentz transformation at hand. And, okay, yes, I will finish also before. It has to do only with the translations. So it doesn't matter if I rotate the observers. This is natural because the different observers are comparing position, not direction. In general, I can have any monomial of all the functions, those are the generators, and they only depend on this Lorentz transformation. This is when I transform the original state with a wave function, in the representation of the kappa prime Carré algebra. So this is the wave function of the observer, who himself will be described by a wave function. So the state x prime is identical to the state that I would get from a nu. The a nu don't commute. So basically, translating gives me something which is localized there. Okay, now, if I have in general a state which is not the state at the origin, it's possible to see, it's a calculation which I don't reproduce, that all uncertainty of the transport coordinate delta mu are, so if I translate, I have an uncertainty, and they are induced by delta a mu. Due to the non-commutative translation, we do not precisely where the new observer, unless the observer is just a time translation of the origin. It is also possible to see, and this is a calculation, that the uncertainty of states increases with translation. So if I have a state which is uncertain for me, something somewhere, and then I translate it, no matter in which direction, even if I bring it closer to me, the uncertainty increases. So I know less what happens to it. Okay, I will finish, but let me dwell 1 second on these conclusions. First, the outlook. There are some obvious things to do in this context. As I say, there are some cases which were not unique. And it would be interesting to see how many of the qualitative conclusions depend on them. In particular, the representation of the algebra, x0, xi, with x0 dilations, there will always be a dilation, but they can be multiplied by a function of position. So there can be things which change, and one may look at this. Also with the numbers, then there are normalizations. I used always one length, lambda. This is natural, but there can be also, in the set of distribution, different choices. And I have chosen particular basis of realization of kappa Poincaré. The choice was basically because Flavio Mercati, that was the person that among us knew kappa Minkowski better than others, was particularly conversant with them. But there can be interesting things which happens. But this is more important. Before this, some aspects are still anecdotal. There are no proof that some statements are really general. When I say proof, although the talk has been, of course, a bit less rigorous. In the paper, we write distributions there to be, and there are some things which we don't prove. We show examples, wide spaces of examples, and they're probably, I'm quite sure that they can be proven, but I'm not 100% sure. But the important thing is that I consider a regime which is not very natural in physics. I have a quantum space-time which the non-commutative parameter of space is non-zero, but I didn't consider h-bar. Why? Because bringing h-bar into the picture will require to consider momenta, and they connect with translations, and translations are non-commuting, and when they are non-commuting, L breaks loose. Momenta, Gianni Amelino would say that they form a curved manifold, and Amelino, Camelia, Smolin, Friedel, and Kowalski, Glitzman. The principle of relative locality, I would say.
Yeah, yeah.
The four authors, they have this principle of relative locality. Le Majid, Majid is another person about this curvature. Amelino, Camelia, and you, no?
I was doing it in 88. All of that came 10 years later.
Quoting, the four people that I was quoting are the principle of relative locality, which, interestingly enough, reaches conclusions which are not incompatible with ours. Also, they have that faraway observers cannot be localized. I must confess that I'm not totally, let me say, I have not totally understood the principle of relative locality, but these things, Shan and other people, these things were in there. What we did was, and this is not probably evident from the paper, to do everything with the distributions and the interpretation. So, but of course, now one has to put the two of them together, and this is a challenge, and sooner or hopefully somebody, hopefully me and someone else or something else will, someone else will do it. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you for that.